Listening Library presents Fault Lines in the Constitution, The Framers, Their Fights, and the Flaws That Affect Us Today, by Cynthia Levinson and Sanford Levinson. Read for you by Mark Bramhall, Arthur Morey, Kimberly Farr, Erin Spencer, and Adenrele Ojo.
The convention, though comprising so many distinguished characters, could not be expected to make a faultless government. George Mason, delegate to the Constitutional Convention from Virginia. Manners and opinions change with the change of circumstances. Institutions must advance also and keep pace with the times. Former President of the United States.
Introduction. About this book. Most Americans take pride in the Constitution that established our system of self-government, but in 1787, the men called framers, who crafted it at the Constitutional Convention, weren't at all certain about the decisions they were making. They debated heatedly, each predicting the frightful results of the other's ideas. Then they negotiated, hoping that their compromises would head off disaster and provide stable ways to govern their new country. In some cases, though, the structures of our government, the parts that the framers hardwired into the Constitution, can cause havoc in real life. Some of the crises we've faced since 1787 have resulted from, or were helped along by, limitations, ambiguities, and flatly bad ideas in the Constitution. It might be appealing to believe that because the Constitution and our country have survived this long, they'll always do so. But the framers were not so confident. Perhaps you shouldn't be, either. What is a constitution? Why have one? A constitution is an agreement that describes how an organization is governed. It is different from a collection of laws. The purpose of a constitution is to determine who makes the laws, how those decision makers are chosen, how long they serve, and what powers they have. Constitutions can be broad outlines or detailed rules about how to make laws. They can emerge through discussion or by force. Almost all countries, except Britain, New Zealand, and Israel, have written constitutions. So do all 50 states, Puerto Rico, most American Indian nations, and many organizations, including civic groups, clubs, and schools. Regardless of how it is developed and what it contains, a constitution is intended to help a group of people accept leadership and reduce friction. That's the idea, at any rate. From independence to a constitutional convention. In the Declaration of Independence, issued on July 4, 1776, the 13 United States of America pronounced themselves
free and independent states, with full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. The Declaration of Independence.
But their independence was about the only thing these states could agree on. You'd probably notice that United isn't capitalized in United States in some versions of the Declaration. The term was merely a vague and not very accurate description. The states were free and independent not only from Britain, but also from each other. 13 disjointed mini-republics were strung along the Atlantic seaboard, not really part of a cohesive country under a single government. Each state had its own political system, money, and constitution. The people living in these states did not think of themselves as Americans.
Virginia, sir, is my country. Thomas Jefferson. Massachusetts is our country. John Adams.
Without a king to order them around, the states had to figure out how to get along with each other and how to reach decisions everyone would abide by, even when some states objected to them. America's first president. The Articles of Confederation established the office of the presidency, with each appointed executive serving 1 year. So America's first president was not George Washington, but John Hanson, a public official and revolutionary from Maryland. As explained at the one and only Presidential Museum in Williamsfield, Ohio, Washington was our ninth. However, not one of the first eight presidents had any real power.
It is the first instance from the creation of the world that free inhabitants have been seen deliberating on a form of government. James Madison.
Each state sent delegates to a sort of governing body, the Confederation Congress. There, all together in one room, they tried to resolve such disputes as border lines, especially on the endless-seeming western frontier, and how much money to cough up to pay for the war they were fighting, and, after 1781, had won. The separate states operated under a set of rules, or treaties, called the Articles of Confederation and Perpetual Union. These had been devised in 1777 to carry out the war, though they didn't go into effect until 1781. The Articles set up a League of Friendship, as the states described their alliance. Severe problems surfaced almost immediately. Every state was allotted one vote in this Congress, regardless of its size. But big states with large populations, such as Virginia, argued that they were entitled to more votes than little ones, such as Rhode Island. Furthermore, the delegates often didn't show up, and when they did, they spent much of their time bickering, after which they went home empty-handed and frustrated. There was a limit to what the delegates could accomplish. The Articles had given Congress few powers beyond making treaties with other countries and printing money, which turned out to be nearly worthless. Probably worst of all, the national government was not allowed to tax the citizenry. All it could do was issue requests, called requisitions, for money from the states, which often ignored them. Consequently, the Treasury didn't have enough money even to pay the soldiers who had fought and won the Revolutionary War. In June 1783, 400 of those soldiers stormed Congress's headquarters in Philadelphia, clamoring for their back pay, and locked the delegates inside. When the officials were finally released, they had to run for their lives. They stayed a step ahead of the soldiers, conducting business in a series of temporary quarters in Maryland, New Jersey, and New York. In 1786, Congress tried to requisition $3.8 million, worth about $100 million today, to pay off war debts, including soldiers' back pay. The states forked over a measly $663. It wasn't long before Alexander Hamilton referred to the imbecility of the Articles of Confederation. Meanwhile, states imposed their own taxes on residents, taxes so high that many farmers lost their land and were thrown into paupers' prisons. In Massachusetts, a band of 2,000 men rebelled. Armed with pitchforks and led by Daniel Shays, a former captain of the Continental Army, they executed hit-and-run vigilante raids on munitions depots, surrounded courthouses, and mobbed sheriffs to protest their rising debts. Both the national government and the states were in turmoil. Neither the Articles of Confederation nor the states' own constitutions provided a solution. George Washington despaired. "I predict the worst consequences from a half-starved, limping government, always moving upon crutches and tottering at every step," he lamented. His friend General Henry Lee begged Washington to use his influence to quell the uprising. Realizing that the crises went far beyond rampaging farmers, Washington responded, "Influence is not government. Let us have one by which our lives, liberties, and properties will be secured." Monumental change was needed, and quickly, if the United States were to survive as a genuine union. A likely alternative might be dissolving into several separate, sparring countries. To prevent such chaos, Congress called for a convention of delegates from the states to convene in Philadelphia on May 13, 1787. States called themselves large either because they had a large population or because, like Georgia and South Carolina, they hoped to grow quickly. Pennsylvania, Connecticut, and Rhode Island were ending slavery, but owners there still held people enslaved. Rhode Island did not send anyone to the Constitutional Convention. Vermont considered itself an independent country, but none of the other states recognized it as one. Distinguished characters. At first, hardly anyone showed up. Many dreaded abandoning their families, farms, and businesses to make the tiresome, jarring trek by stagecoach or horseback. The city had never seen as much rain as it did that spring, and the roads were clogged with mud. But by May 25th...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.